In this episode of Cycling Tours, I will explore the cycling network within the eastern sector of Tampines. Hey everybody, Transit Evolution is here again to bring you a video featuring the cycling network in Tampines East. And I will start and end this video at the East-West Line station of Tampines, where I am pushing my bicycle. Tampines is the regional center of the East, and the largest new town in Singapore by number of flats, right now and in the foreseeable future. A town of such size would naturally have a sprawling cycling network. Hence, I'll have to traverse it over three separate videos for the East, West, and North. Even then, this will not be exhaustive, as the cycling network of Tampines is still expanding as we speak. This is partly because of new housing developments in Neighbourhood 6, more commonly known as Tampines North. But the network is also expanding in the existing east side of Tampines. Under contract AM106, first announced in July 2022, for which construction is currently ongoing, many cycling paths along roadways, like Tampines Avenue 2, Avenue 7, Street 24, and Street 42, will be constructed between now and 2026. A cycling bridge to Pasir Ris and a cycling underpass to Simei would also be built. For this series of videos, I will not cover those places unless I have to pass by them. Instead, I will only cover cycling paths that were meant to be completed by 2024. Some of these paths that appear grey, like this one over here, or black, which we will see later, were built a long time ago. Other paths may also appear unmarked, as work is currently in progress to repaint them to the new design under contract AM106. The remaining ones with modern designs, like the one I'm about to travel on along Tampines Avenue 5, were built under contract PL203, awarded in 2018. Therefore, I expect this video to get outdated pretty quickly, but it will still provide a pretty accurate look at the state of the cycling network for those watching in the year 2024. For now, I'm travelling southwards along Tampines Avenue 5, along the western edge of Neighbourhood 1. Let's reconvene when we reach the neighbourhood centre. Let's have a look at the cycling path wrapping around the neighbourhood centre of Neighbourhood 1, which features the Tampines Round Market and Food Court, built with local shophouse architecture in mind, with pitch roofs, deep overhanging eaves, and tall windows. This cycling path was built in 2015 under a Tampines Town Council initiative, connecting the neighbourhood centre with adjacent housing along Tampines Street 11. It's extremely off-road and windy, and not very practical for travelling anywhere else. However, if there's anything which I like about this cycling path, it is the use of arrows indicating where you should position your bicycle along this bidirectional path. Modern bidirectional road cycling paths feature neither arrows nor lane markings, and the vagueness caused by it can cause conflicts between opposing bicycle traffic, as it doesn't communicate well the need to keep to the left half of the cycling path for it to function as intended. Another feature which I like is the use of zebra crossings, which better communicate the need to give way to pedestrians at common conflict points when compared to the shed or attention zones. Crossing Tampines Lane, a roadway with the sole purpose of giving cars unusually direct access to the PIE, I passed Treasure at Tampines, a recent condominium development here. A cycling path was painted along its frontage, but it doesn't lead anywhere. This is something which we will encounter more in coming years, as cycling paths are built into the frontage of various developments, right from the start. Now, for the Town Council cycling path on the other side of the street. It leads to bicycle parking, not very useful, but I guess I see the intention here. It's also very narrow, and probably cannot accommodate two bicycles passing each other. Next up, let's move on to the Tampines Park Connector. Two distinct park connectors go by the same name in Tampines, both of which will be covered in this video. One of them travels from north to south, along Sungai Tampines and the east-west MRT line tracks. The other travels from west to east, along Bedok Reservoir Road and Tampines Avenue 2. We'll have a look at the east-west one first. By park connector standards, this is probably one of the least polished ones in the vicinity. It was built around 2009, and has been patched up pretty haphazardly ever since. The jerk is strong enough at the interfaces between pavements to make my GoPro camera kowtow, and I have to hold on to it to keep it facing forward. As the journey continues along this park connector, I would like to briefly point out that this part of Tampines, both neighbourhoods 1 and 2, on both sides of this road, are amongst the oldest part of this new town, built as early as 1982. The park connector switches to the other side of the avenue under the MRT tracks, which is also where the other branch of the park connector with the same name intersects. This is because further east, the park connector was built at a later date, sometime in late 2013. This must have been the low point in the development of the park connector network here, and the source of many's distrust of the park connector branding, because a barely there path like this, with narrow widths next to drains, apparently counts as a park connector. This will be the only cycling infrastructure along this roadway until a cycling path is built on the north side of this avenue, 2 years from now. the center of neighborhood 2 will be passing by me on the opposite side at this point. It will however be hard to get a glimpse of it from here, since the neighborhood is bisected by this 6-lane roadway. Crossing Tampines Street 32, the park connector ends. Supposedly, you will turn right here to continue along the Tampines Loyang Park connector if you want to follow an official cycling route. But most people trying to get somewhere will have to cycle through this to get to Tampines East MRT station. Of course, a cycling path will eventually be built here, though as part of a project to improve traffic flow along this stretch of Tampines Avenue 2. We can now tell that it takes 12 minutes to get from the center of neighborhood 1 to Tampines East MRT station, compared to the 7 minutes by the few parallel trunk services along this transit priority corridor. I then travel along one of the many grey cycling paths built back in 2013 as part of an early Land Transport Authority initiative. It's not very good though, and appears to be tacked on to the then piecemeal network, without much consideration of where walkers are supposed to travel along the pathways. You may see a wayfinding map board to my left passing by around now, as part of an initiative for the Tampines walking and cycling town. There are such boards along Tampines Avenues 1, 4 and 5 as well, and perhaps even more in other places. But being placed in such inconspicuous locations, they are hard to notice. I will now start the journey along the Tampines Loyang Park Connector from Loyang Flyover. This park connector is not new, but the surfacing here is, and that's because it got realigned when this stretch of Tampines Avenue 7 was widened from 4 lanes to 6 back in 2020, to the point where the park connector now sits directly next to a precinct driveway and gets a little too narrow at times. Strangely, the park connector continues along Tampines Street 34, where you get a nice wide path leading to only cycling paths. I am now in the heart of Neighborhood 3, which was built much later than Neighborhood 2, with housing blocks that were completed between 1992 and 1997. This might be because this area was originally meant for industrial users, according to the initial land use plan back in 1980. That did not materialize. East Spring Secondary, East Spring Primary, and Ngee-Ann Secondary are schools which you will find in this area, and the cycling paths are built on the opposite side of the street for the latter two. You can sense that the urban green is a lot denser here. Gone are the spacious setbacks of housing blocks in the earlier two neighborhoods. This neighborhood features Tampines Mart as its neighborhood center, passing by on my right, in the form of a single shopping mall, rather than a collection of low-rise blocks. A red cycling path runs along Tampines Street 33, a two-lane silver zone street, serving as the only road link for the precincts here, being bounded by the Tampines and Pan Island expressways on its other side. Crossing the street, I head onto a cycling path along Street 32. It has a very different texture to it, looking a lot like yet another cycling path built under a town council initiative. And indeed, it is. This bicycle path is one of the oldest in this town, dating back to around 2009. It is one of the two original paths in Tampines, which aimed to provide a direct cycling route from the neighborhood to Tampines MRT station at the regional center, which together has a length of 2.3 kilometers. You can see the western path in the video for Tampines West, but this eastern path travels on a relatively direct route along Tampines Street 32 and Street 23. The cycling path crosses Tampines Avenue 2 here. Notice the presence of bicycle icons on this zebra crossing, which might be there to allow cyclists to ride across the roadway without the need to dismount and push, based on the laws of back in the day. This is about the most indication of cycling infrastructure, which you will see when it comes to the intersection of a cycling route with a roadway in Singapore. And unfortunately, that makes even well-meaning cycling routes feel discontinuous. You wouldn't have known that this series of paths I'm travelling along right now were designed to connect neighbourhoods 2 and 3 with the MRT station if I didn't tell you that, would you? The cycling path switches to the south side of Tampines Street 23 at this mid-block bicycle crossing over here, which is a little annoying since I took quite a bit of time to switch to the north side earlier. Regular switches like this make a cycling journey longer and less competitive with alternative transport modes. I just want to note that to use the bicycle path as designed, you're supposed to turn left up ahead and cross that zebra crossing, before cycling on the car park road in front of me, through Festival Park. Both the car park and Festival Park are all of the syllabus of this video. It will not be considered a proper bicycle path and is no longer considered a part of Tampines' cycling network, but it is admittedly more direct. Rather, I will travel along the northern half of Tampines Street 21 first, where we'll have a look at a pretty new cycling path, once I cross Street 24. This cycling path passes by a newer housing precinct, 230 A2J Tampines Avenue 7, completed in 1993. It features an unusual curved facade as seen from that road. The cycling path becomes shared as I pass Tampines Chinese Temple, with Pasir Ris Secondary on the other side, but it wouldn't be long before the path becomes segregated again. It takes 11.5 minutes to get here from the easternmost bus stop in this town, compared to the 8 minutes it would take on feeder 291. However, you can cycle directly to the east-west line station, while 291 takes a 1D route near the town centre, and you will still have to walk from the bus interchange to the MRT station anyway. We will deal with Tampines Park Connector later, but for now, let's fast forward to Tampines Street 41, where I pass Sun Plaza View. This cycling path was one of the early ones, although not the earliest one, built by the authorities in 2013 under contract RP228A, which aimed to get the cycling network here to a length of 11.3 kilometers. It will have continued along Tampines Avenue 9, therefore serving as the main cycling route connecting the core of Neighborhood 4 with the town center of Tampines. Today, much of its paint has been stripped away as it awaits a remarking of the cycling path. Passing the future Sun Plaza Spring Precinct, the street abruptly turns left. You can't go straight here, as it leads to a car park for some reason. A short cycling path was built along Tampines Street 43, a dead-end street for motorists, but a true route to the stretch of the Tampines Park Connector along Sungai Tampines. The Park Connector may be a recreational route, but it can also be useful for residents in this vicinity to get to Pasir Ris and Tampines town centres, such as those in Tampines alcoves, and this short link provides even more commuting options within the network. I shall now turn back at this pedestrian overhead bridge across the TPE, which will be replaced by a cycling bridge in 2026 to Pasir Ris. Watch the cycling tours video for Pasir Ris East to see how the park connector continues to Pasir Ris Park. I will now travel along the length of the park connector within the town of Tampines, along a path which forms an integral part of the Eastern Corridor. This path is a little windy, so it's a good thing it's marked as a shared path, because everyone would likely cut corners to travel on a more direct route, leading to confusion if the path was separated into walking and cycling lanes. The concrete canal to my right was recently naturalized in 2022, which increased its drainage capacity by 30%, under the first such project since the one for the Kallang River in Bishan Ang Mo Kio Park. This was not a flood-prone area, however, hence the change was just to soften the concrete hardscape of the canal to make Tampines North more livable. Such naturalisation projects are uncommon due to space constraints, and it's only possible here due to the Tampines Eco Green north of the canal. Even then, the park connector has to hang over the river along certain stretches. Eventually, it merges with Tampines Avenue 9 as a past Tampines North Primary School. I now pass the future Tampines Boulevard Park East to my right and await to cross a mid-block bicycle crossing beneath the East-West Line MRT tracks. This is where the intersection of Tampines Avenue 12 used to meet before its realignment in 2021, and it's good to see that the crossing has been preserved. It is currently a sunny mid-afternoon in Tampines, and the sun is shining from the west. Therefore, I have a pretty comfortable ride here, as the park connector runs east of the train viaduct and is perfectly under its shade through Sun Plaza Park, named after an amphitheatre surrounded by paths that are shaped like a sun when looked from above. Initially known as Tampines Town Park, this park was opened in 1996. It was linked by the year 2000 with Pasir Ris Park and Bedok Reservoir Park through the Tampines Park Connector, one of the earliest ones in Singapore. The Park Connector makes a left turn as it approaches Tampines Avenue 7 and passes by the Sun Plaza Green Precinct, diverging from the train tracks. It continues along Tampines Avenue 4 at a lively intersection featuring Tampines Polyclinic and Tampines North Community Club to my left and Tampines Hut to my right. Completed in 1989, Tampines Hut forms the oldest part of the town centre, with a main pedestrian axis from this intersection, funneling pedestrians to the MRT station. The number of oncoming pedestrians serves as a hint of how pedestrian-friendly that walking route is. It has an interesting roofscape and features design motifs of not just roofs and walls, but columns as well, something which the Housing Board likes to incorporate into housing projects built around this time. The journey along Tampines Park Connector continues under the train viaduct again, with a dedicated bicycle path to the left and a pedestrian path to the right. Under a 5-year master plan, the Tampines Town Council recently enhanced this thoroughfare with landscaping features like a community plaza, a bike maze, a playground, a fitness corner, a lawn, and a water stream. Here, I cross Tampines Avenue 2, where the park connector continues. At this time of the day, you may encounter pedestrians walking on the cycling path to seek refuge from the harsh sunshine under the shade that the MRT viaduct provides. Many people will walk along this route, as the bus connectivity in the blocks further away from Tampines Avenue 2 is inevitably poor due to the way the street layout is laid, with only one bus service serving Street 11 and Street 22 along a windy route. That bus service is feeder 292, which takes 9 minutes to get from the bus interchange, not the MRT station, to this vicinity, and it doesn't consider wait times. In contrast, it only takes 4.5 minutes to get here on a bicycle from the MRT station. With such a big time disparity, it's no wonder that this is a popular last mile commuting route for both walking and cycling. The park connector makes a sharp deviation to the left to meet a pedestrian overhead bridge across the Penn Island Expressway, where we will continue through the Simei Park connector. A cycling underpass is still at least 2 years away from being completed. You can continue the journey on the cycling tours video for Changi Simei, but for this video, I'll return to traversing the remaining cycling paths yet to be covered in Tampines East. I'm now along Tampines Street 12, featuring one of the newest cycling paths in Tampines, which was intended to be completed this year. No bus services travel through this street, although it will provide an even more direct route from Tampines Station to Avenue 2. That's what makes cycling so time competitive in this vicinity. Anyways, this path passes on the opposite side of the street from Tampines Primary and Secondary Schools. It is so new that parts of it have not been marked yet. Next up, back to Tampines Street 21, I want to note that there are pedestrian crossings on only two of the three lakes at its intersection with Tampines Avenue 4. It would be great if a last missing crossing could be installed to further enhance the walkability and cyclability of the area. That's because a cycling path is also running along the south side of the street. This path serves a distinctively different purpose from the one in the north, because there's no way to ride across the street beyond the intersection we passed. The paths diverge when this southern path makes a right turn at the street's junction with itself, instead of going straight. Notice that the Old Town Council cycling path I mentioned earlier intersects with this path here, and you will have to either push your bicycle across the road or make a detour to get to the car park due to the lack of a direct curb cut. Making room for a cycling or shared path is an exercise of geometry here. And as we are testing the limits of cramming new infrastructure into an existing built environment, the path becomes a little more crooked. Things get a bit janky as I approach Yumin Primary School, which boundary fence was realigned to make room for a cycling path. But after making a crossing, there won't even be a shared path left. The stretch beyond the next junction will have to wait until 2026. At this zebra crossing, the Town Council cycling path reappears. Next up, I'll be travelling along Tampines Avenue 9, but to get there, I will have to travel along a stretch with a yet-to-be-marked cycling path, along Tampines Avenue 2. Tampines Avenue 9 is a work in progress. The cycling path here was originally built in 2013, but they are currently being updated to match the latest typology. For now, though, anything goes. Crossing Tampines Street 44, I directly pass the centre of Neighbourhood 4, built around 1985. This neighbourhood centre is the manifestation of the grand design approach of its time, the use of symmetric building forms to enclose distinct civic spaces. The blocks, arranged in the shape of a heart, are flanked by the Tampines branch of All Saints Home to its east and that of Victory Family Centre to its west. Thank you. It takes 8.5 minutes to get to the western edge of Neighbourhood 4 from Tampines East MRT station. No direct bus alternative as is. 18, 28 and 29 all require a little walking. Here, I managed to cross Tampines Street 43 and 41 without having to stop at a traffic light. You do have to be very careful though, and remember to look out for potential oncoming traffic before crossing, since discretionary right turns are still a thing at these intersections. At this point, I'm about to enter a more secluded part of Tampines, before returning to the town centre. Let's take this time to conclude with a bit of context. Tampines has always been a place with higher than usual bicycle commuting volumes, partially thanks to its geography. It's big, dense and flat. It was the first town in Singapore where cycling on footpaths is allowed, under a trial in 2007, which was legalised under Town Council bylaws in 2010. Hence, when it got its cycling paths, it was designated as the first cycling town in Singapore. Yes, Sembawang and Pasir Ris had town council cycling paths even before then, but those were atrocious. 17 years later, the network in Tampines has gotten much more comprehensive, and its substandard paths of the past are getting improved, but the network is still far from complete. I do find it a little strange that the progress here has been slow, given its much more lengthy cycling history, such that Yishun and Jurong East have better coverage than Tampines in some ways. But this will likely change shortly, and I have optimism that things will get even better here, come 2026. Travelling along Tampines Central 4, I come to the end of this episode of Cycling Tours. Do leave your thoughts on how you find cycling in Tampines to be. Do remember to hit the subscribe button and the notification bell if you have not done so, to keep yourself updated with my future videos. Feel free to support me using the Super Thanks function of YouTube. Till next time, this is Transit Evolution, signing off.